Okay, so this lecture will be more guided towards transiester and the NHF formalism used in transiester, where we are self-consistently solving the Green's function methods to calculate the self-consistent solution of the electronic structure. Again, this will go over quite fast, so please just ask questions in the Q&A and we'll try to go through them one by one. So this is the outline of this part. Again, we will try to make it 15 minutes and then a short break and then reiterate here. So I will go through how to create a benzene diethyl geometry step by step, how I would set up a geometry for transiester calculations, what one should be aware of, what one should be cautious about. What you have been working on so far have been tight binding calculations. And there this interplay between electrodes and the device region isn't really, I mean, you know what you have there, you know what you have of couplings, and you know what the potential landscape looks like. But when you are starting to do density functional theory calculation in combination with the Green's function method, it's not as trivial in this sense, simply due to the screening length of your device region. Okay. So again, if you understand this, then it's quite trivial to set up any type of geometry. You should just be sure that your electrodes behave as your bulk electrodes, as your bulk properties of that given electrode. So always have this in the back of your head when you initiate a calculation. Is my screening sufficiently good enough to have a short distance between my electrode and the starting region? Or do I really need to have more electrode layers to screen off the device region? So here you again have all these different possibilities. And as you recall, you could put in your self energy here in the last H knot block. Anything, if you put it anywhere behind this H knot, you would get the same result. If you put it afterwards, you'll get a wrong result. And transiester cannot check this for you. This has to be your responsibility to do the proper convergence test and ensuring that your screening towards your electrodes is sufficiently good. Yeah, the electrostatics are long range. So have this at the back of your head always. So in this benzene diethyl example, we'll be using an AB stacking gold surface electrode. And in this case, it's the 100 where you have this AB stacking. And there you can see that you have four layers in this case. Two layers would be too short because you would have more than nearest neighbor cell interactions. And therefore you need four layers. Whether you only need three or you actually need the four, that depends on the basis set range. But generally you would always need at least three, I would say. Then you need to decide your K-point sampling in your transverse directions. So you have to convert your electronic structure for your electrode and for your device region. So they may not behave exactly the same in the Brillouin zone. So you should converge both of them, both your electrode and your device region, to be sure that you get the correct or your physical expectations. So again, this is your responsibility. You should be sure that you are sufficiently sampling the Brillouin zone correctly. Then there's I have a small hinted question. So is there anything special about this electrode? And yes, there is. This one has a periodicity along the transverse direction. So transport is in this case going up out of the screen. But the transverse directions being into the screen and horizontally, there you have a periodicity in terms of block repetitions. So this is a 3x3 block repetition of this electrode. And if you did TB04 and TB05, you should have experienced the value of using a block repetition. It's much, much faster to utilize the block repetition because you are not inverting the same big matrices over and over again. So your first step is to figure out how you should define your electrodes. Then you need to define your scattering region. In this case, it's this benzene diethyl molecule. So you relax it. You can start by relaxing this without adding any kind of gold surface layers. So you start relaxing this. Then you attach some pyramids that are going to be your connectivity towards your electrodes. And here you need to consider how you want to stack them or attach your molecule towards the electrode. So this could be an A layer BDT A layer, or an A BDTB, or B BDTB, or of course also B BDTA, if so desired. So then again, you relax your structures and constrain the pyramids to be sure that you are kind of stretching your molecule to the desired length. And here it's always a problem of what is the correct distance on the elongation of your molecules, but you have to manually figure out how to do this in the best way, such that your eigenstates and the description of your molecule electronic structure is sufficiently good. Then you add a couple of more layers, relax structure again, and now you are going to constrain only the outermost layers there. So then you will be relaxing the pyramids and the molecule together. And then finally, you attach the electrodes. You should never relax electrodes in a transistor calculation because you are, the whole scheme of transistor relies on having a bulk electrode. So it means that your electrodes are functioning as though it was really the semi-infinite part of the electrode. So if you have any kind of displacement of the atoms in the electrodes, it's not a bulk electrode, or at least it's not the same bulk electrode that you have defined in your electrode calculation. So if that's not obeyed, then you are definitely not doing a proper calculation. But transistor will also die, and also TB trans, if the atomic coordinates of your electrodes doesn't match your device, it will tell you about this. So again, here follow the stacking, and for transistor calculations with two electrodes where you have periodicity along the transport direction, it's important that you also try to adhere to any stacking order you have. So if you have AB-AB stacking, it doesn't work if you have BA-BA and then AB-AB on the other side. That is not going to work. You'll introduce a potential barrier in the stacking fold, and that will translate into a worse SCF cycle. So if you want that stacking order, you should use a buffer layer to ensure you have the correct stacking and to screen off any defect towards the electrode region. Now you may argue that that's not really important because you're really not using that part of the electrode in your calculation, but it really helps in the self-consistency cycle, because what transistor does is it starts with a siesta calculation and uses that as the initial guess of your transistor calculation. And that's important to realize what that means of the self-consistency cycle. So the closer you are to a bulk property in the scattering region and in the electrode regions, the better convergence you'll have. So again, relax structure, but you are still going to relax the electrode layers out here and also up here and down here. So here, this is where it gets important. You need to ensure that your screening length is sufficiently small such that your electrodes out here, the gray atoms area, are really truly bulk parts of your electrodes. So here there are just two small questions. I'll give you 45 seconds to think about. So what does a metallic electrode require? And what does a semiconducting electrode require? I'll count down 45 seconds. Okay, so the answer is that the metallic electrodes, they require, they have a very good screening, so they require very few extra electrode layers. So here in this case, you have three extra electrode layers in the top part and only two layers in the bottom part. That may be okay in this case, actually. The problem happens for a semiconducting electrode. You have a very bad screening, which means that you require a very, very long number of, or very, very long electrode relaxation layer. And that is not so feasible in a DFT calculation. So again, this comes back to our discussion in the previous presentation that semiconducting electrodes is something you should really be cautious about in Transistor. And you should not really do this without without extreme caution. It doesn't tell you anything when you start a transistor calculation. It doesn't prohibit you from doing it with a semiconductor. But the chances of you doing something wrong is extremely high. And I would definitely not recommend to do it without proper care. Okay. I think, let me just see here. Yeah, I think I can just take this one and then that should be it. Let me get back to how we calculate the density matrix in the transistor scheme, because that's also important for the numerical details and how the performance is of transistor. So here, just a small quick recap. We have the Green's function, which is the inversion of a big matrix. We have the scattering matrix, which is a dense matrix. And then we have this the scattering states here, or the spectral function here. If all the electrodes have the same Fermi distribution, then we can easily calculate the density using only the Green's function. And the derivation looks like this. The total density is the sum of all the spectral functions for all of the electrodes, but you can manipulate this into a very simple equation that looks like this down here. So you'll notice up here that this is the spectral function where you have a triple matrix product, but down here it's only the Green's functions. Then to add some the non-equilibrium parts, we make a trick which adds the spectral functions in a small bias window. So that depends on the chemical potentials and the difference between the chemical potentials. And this enters via these terms out here. But in some cases, you have the case that's particularly true if you have more than two electrodes. You may come up in the case where you have two electrodes with the same chemical potential. And if that's the case, you can reduce this equation to something that's a little bit simpler. But it's still quite heavy in this case. So the way that we are calculating our equilibrium part is via this complex residue theorem from complex analysis. And what we are really interested in is this part, the green one down here. I will not go into the details of this residue theorem, but suffice to know that you can calculate this line integral here along the R part by only calculating L, C, and all the poles in here. So all the marked dots in here. And this turns out to be much, much more efficient if you do it only up here in the complex plane, because the states, as we saw in the previous presentation, the density of states gets broadened by a large imaginary part. And essentially, if you have a very, very high imaginary part, you just get a flat band or wide band approximation. So that's sort of the basic principle of this. It's a much faster calculation to do it like this, numerically at least. So if you have two chemical potentials, you have to have two different contours, and they are just shifted according to your chemical potentials along the energy axis, but the same principle holds. Yeah. And I think that's 15 minutes. I think we will take 5 minutes. So put a timer.
Maybe you can have a look at the questions before.
Ah, yeah, of course. Yeah. Sorry. I thought I would get a ping here, but sorry. So Shamik asks, discuss the mathematics behind mixing in transiester. So in the mixing in transiester is no different than the mixing in regular siester calculations. You can still use Poulet mixing or Broyden mixing or linear mixing, whatever you want. So there's no real discussion. What generally happens is that it's better to mix the Hamiltonian in a transiester method, but it's also system dependent. Sometimes it's good to use Hamiltonian mixing. Other times it may be more beneficial to do density matrix mixing. So yeah, the default option is to use Hamiltonian mixing. So you should just try that out. If it doesn't work, then you can play around with the other ones. I think that answers also Shamik's second question, which is, for example, DM mixing SCF equals true. I think that's also covered in my answer. So then Saba asks how to identify same and different Fermi distributions. That comes in the next part, so I'll answer that in the next section. Koval asks, what are the poles set in along the imaginary axis? So that's because of the residue theorem. So that's the right-hand side of this equation here. And they come about because of the Fermi distribution. So if you work out the poles of the Fermi function, you'll find that these poles are equally spaced by 2 pi times the electronic temperature in Rydbergs. So a very, very small electronic temperature means that your spacing will be very small and you will be requiring a large number of poles, which hurts performance because you need to do more inversions. And if you have a very, very high electronic temperature, the spacing between your poles will be bigger and you don't need that many poles. Constantine, how to set properly the contours? So generally the default options of transiester is quite sufficient, I would say. The important thing about this contour is that you need to ensure that the lower part of this circle is far below your lowest eigenvalue in your device. And as long as you are, say, below minus 50, minus 40 EV, you should be fine. Of course, if you have semi-core states, you should be a little bit more cautious. But you can generally just do a check of the eigenvalues you find in your electrodes and just be sure that you are far below the values you found, the minimum value you find in that file. And that should be sufficient for by far the largest part of your calculations. But in any case, I mean, you can just move it down. This is a residue theorem. And since it's in the complex plane, you are really broadening a lot of the states and it shouldn't really affect the end results too much. Alexandra writes, how to migrate self-energies from real to reciprocal space. What is the advantage of calculating self-energy in reciprocal space? So I'm not sure I completely followed this question. If you want to do, we have an exercise about real space self energies, but some use the real space in a different way, only discussing the gamma point self energy and not what I would call the real space, which is the Brillouin zone integrated self energy. So it depends on exactly what you mean, but generally it's always better to use the real space, which is the Brillouin zone integrated self energy. But that requires a much bigger system because you really need to disconnect your images in your transistor calculation. I don't know if that answers the question, but otherwise you can ask in the next session as well. Parvati asks, how does stacking of electrodes affect transport? That's of course depending on the electrode. I mean, if it's aluminum or if it's gold or silver or whatever, then the stacking may of course change. It's only due to the electronic structure of your electrodes, how the states are there in the energy space. So you may see different sections depending on the orientation of your electrodes. Can you differentiate between brown and gray layer of atoms in structure? So I think that was here. So here, the difference between the brown and the gray areas is that the gray areas are electrode layers and they have to be exactly bulk-like. So they are the electrode atoms as you find them in your electrode calculation. They have to match exactly the coordinates of your device region coordinates must match exactly the electrode coordinates in the gray areas.
Up to a constant shift, right?
Yeah, up to a constant shift. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. True. Constantine, when calculating IV characteristics in non-equilibrium states, TBT contour line range should be wider than TS contour NEQ by default. So the question is whether the TBT contour line should be different from the TS contour non-equilibrium part. So the default value of the non-equilibrium contours ranges from, it's actually partly going to be discussed in the next section, but not the TB transoption. But if you just want to calculate the current from a given geometry, you only need to integrate in the Fermi window. You don't care about what's happening at minus 10 eV, because that doesn't enter in your current calculation. So I hope that answers the question. Otherwise, please ask again. Radu asks, most some semiconductors are insulators at the temperatures where transistor is computing zero Kelvin. Can you have transport between two insulators, and why should one compute transport between semiconductors? Where can I find out more about the contours? So again, an insulator is just the same as a semiconductor. I wouldn't do it. It's the same problem about screening layers and don't do it. That's my recommendation. If you are still going to do it, you should really know what you're doing. So really be cautious about insulators and semiconductors. Yeah, for the complex contour, search about residue theorem. You'll find tons of information. This is a common problem in mathematics, and it's not too difficult in this case. Okay. So Shamiga asks, can one calculate conductance and mobility by using TB trans? Yeah, you can calculate conductance and which utility will be favorable. In principle, you can calculate it. Mobility is a little bit more tricky, but conductance, you can easily do that. Constantine asks, the Fermi window, how to choose the range, find a compromise of precision and CPU time when integrating within two large window. Again, the current calculation of If you're calculating only interested in the current of a given geometry, you are only going to be using energy points in your Fermi range. So that's the difference between two chemical potentials. So there's no point in extending your contours in your TB trans calculations if you're only interested in the current. Again, you should still be cautious about K-point sampling and energy grid spacing, because these ones tend to be more depending on these issues. The K-point sampling is, of course, to have captured all states, and that's the same for the energy spacing. So you need to converge that if the currents or the transmissions change depending on your energy and your K-point spacing, then you probably haven't reached the convergence point yet.